training with power has become one of the most talked about ways of both improving performance and fitness in recent years. Gone are the days of being out slogging yourself for hours on end and, well, just hoping for the best in terms of fitness. However, what's really important is actually the consistency of data in which you're getting back from a power meter. As much as we all like to think we've got a really high number, if it's wildly inaccurate, well, it's not really going to help you, is it? So, thanks to our friends at PowerTap, we've got a few different ways in which we can measure power whilst you're riding along. So come on, let's go and take a look at them.
Now, where exactly are we going to measure all this power from then? Well, we've got five different devices that we are going to connect to and see just how accurate that data can be. First up is the PowerTap Rear Hub. Now, the PowerTap Hub system has been around for about 20 years now. Obviously, during that time, it's undergone some refinements and developments, and it's gone from what was initially a wired unit to what we now have, a wire-free unit, which is good news for everyone out there who doesn't like extra wires on their bikes. So this is the G3 Hub, and as you can see, it's an oversized hub shell unit, which all of the strain gauges and electronics are actually housed within, and then the torque you're putting through the rear wheel is transferred, that data into power, sent onto the head unit. Now, it is a very easy installation process. If you buy a pre-built wheel, it's simply a case of putting it in the bike, pairing it up to your head unit, and away you go. There's also no need to send the wheel back to a service center in the case of a battery change. It is easily done by yourself at home, so simply unscrewing the end cap and then replacing that battery, nice and easy. Now, I have already touched on it, but it is a really great transport piece of power measuring equipment if you've got a few different bikes. So you can simply remove the wheel and then put it into another bike and have power measured from that too. Now, many experts out there actually claim that the hub-based system is one of the most accurate ways to measure power out there, because essentially you've got less variables there going on. So there's less things such as a chainring moving and that kind of thing. Now, PowerTap themselves have actually told me that basically the hub system can sometimes underread that total max power. The reason for that being is obviously with the drivetrain components, you do have a little bit of loss of that raw power being sent through there. However, it is accurate to plus or minus 1.5% accuracy, so you're pretty much on the money there anyway. Now, secondly, and this is a relatively newcomer really to the power meter game, is pedals. So the PowerTap P1 pedals, as you can see, there is the battery which is housed inside of the unit here, as well as the strain gauges. So basically, it's all tucked away nicely underneath the pedal. Initially, they do look like they add a little bit of bulk, but hey, when you're riding along, you can't actually see that anyway, can you? So it doesn't really matter. Now, what do I really like about these pedals? Well, firstly, they're highly portable, aren't they? So if you've got more than one bike, you can easily switch them around from bike to bike, certainly easier than that of a chain set, for instance. And say if you had a hub built onto a training wheel, you wouldn't necessarily want to use that in a race situation, would you? And then we've got AAA batteries too. So if you were in the unfortunate situation and you forgot to actually check how much power was inside of your battery and you ran out, you can easily find a AAA battery from virtually any shop on any street in the world, I guess. Now, data again is transmitted via ANT Plus or Bluetooth. And then in this case, we've actually got dual-sided, so it's a left and right power measurement. So one pedal talks to the other, and then that pedal sends the information to the head unit. Now, there is also the option to run it as a single-sided unit, so you buy a pair of almost identical pedals. Well, they are, other than the right-hand side pedal doesn't have any of the electronics inside of it. Instead, it's the left pedal which transmits the data to the head unit. And then to find out your total power, essentially it doubles that, because most people out there actually have an even split, 50-50, or there or thereabouts. Now, finally, let's talk about the actual cleat system that fits in here. On first look, they do look extremely similar to that of a Look Keo pedal. However, they are slightly more oversized, so if you were to use a Look Keo in there, it's not going to give you that accurate power reading, as well as potentially being dangerous as you could unclip. So it's worth sticking actually with those PowerTap specific cleats, which do come with 6 degrees float or fixed. And just like the hub system, it's accurate to plus or minus 1.5%. Now, next up is the PowerTap C1 Chainring Systems. Now, there's no actual competition on the market for them, as far as I'm aware. So how do they work? So out of the box, they come as a pair of FSA chainrings, which are mounted onto what's essentially a secondary spider, which houses some of the magic of a power meter inside of it. And then it's also got the sender unit, so that's to transmit via ANT Plus or Bluetooth again, as well as the battery, which is fitted onto the chainring too. That then fits onto compatible chain sets. So in this case, it's 110 BCD and that's a 5-arm crank. And then the actual power itself is measured from the outside of the inner chainring, which is really super interesting for me anyway. So interestingly, despite the data collector actually being on the right-hand side of the bike, it does actually measure left-right balance. How's that done though? Well, it's all due to the actual positioning of the chainring. So if you were to put it in a different position on the spider, it's not gonna give you accurate readings. Now, it is actually done on an assumption, basically, of your pedal stroke, so hence the reason for it having to be in the right place on the spider. Heartrate. That's right, I said heart rate. Nothing to do with power, although it is, because this is actually an entry into the power meter game, because using a clever algorithm, you connect this heart rate strap to your head unit, or your smartphone, for instance, and it gives you an estimation, basically, of your power output. Now, naturally, this is nowhere near the cost of anything else on the bike that we're measuring power from, but it is a great entry-level starting point for you to be able to train with power. And the great news out there for people who aren't particularly technically minded when it comes to changing bits around on a bike is, well, it doesn't even have to go on a bike, does it? It just goes on yourself, so you can use it across all of your different bikes. Finally, we've got a crank-based power meter here, this one from Stages, and as you can see, the actual electronic gubbins of it are actually here on the inside of the left-hand crank. So we've got the strain gauges and also a user-changeable battery there too. Doesn't add much weight at all to the actual original crank. And they do actually come in quite a few different varieties too, so matching up with most chain sets out there on the market. And just like all the other power meters, or most of them out there, you've got yourself a user-changeable battery, as well as connecting via ANT Plus or Bluetooth. So we've gone through the 5 different power meters, but how actually are we going to measure and record the data being captured? Well, this is where this comes in handy. Mission control, or something like that. Anyway, I've got 5 Wahoo Element Bolt GPS devices. Each one is paired up to a power meter. I'm now going to go out for a pedal on the bike, and when I get back, I'm going to be able to analyse and see just how consistent each power meter really is. So let's look then at the all-important consistency of the data that's being recorded. Now, this is a little bit of GCN does science, and I'm using DC Rainmaker's analyzer software here. So you can see there is different lines on the graph, and that does represent each power meter that we've used. On the far left-hand side of the screen, we've got the power measured in watts, and that's versus time along here at the bottom. Now, if I was to hover my cursor, basically, it lets me know what power meter is measuring what power up here in the right-hand side. So we can actually see up to the second information, which is pretty cool. Now you can see that there is one power meter which is not tracking quite as high as the rest, but more on that later on. But the good news is that by and large, everything is tracking in the same trajectory, as you can see. So the lines do actually follow the same, which is good news. Now, first of all, let's actually look at the uppermost 3 lines on our graph. So as you can see, they are tracking each other very closely. And on occasion, in fact, the pink and green ones are in fact shadowing one another, giving very similar readings. So what are they? Well, the green one, that's the PowerTap G3, so that's the hub-based unit. And then the pink one is the PowerTap C1. And that is very, very interesting indeed. They do track, like I say, and shadow one another at those peaks and troughs. Now, as for the orange line, well, that's the PowerTap P1 pedals. And you can see, again, it does follow exactly the same lines as the other 2 power meters I've just mentioned. There is a slight dip here just after 11:39. and I know exactly what that was. That's where I encountered some traffic and I actually had to unclip one of my pedals because I had to stop at some traffic lights momentarily before getting going again. So nothing to worry about there. Now those previous three power meters I've just spoke about all actually measure a left and right power measurement, giving the total. Whereas the stages, which is the blue line, just measures the left and then doubles it up and gives you your total power reading. Now I know from a serious crash I had a few years ago that my left leg is considerably weaker than my right, so that could be why it's not giving such high readings, but essentially it is still tracking on the same lines, so we're all good there. Now for the black line. So this represents the Powercal, which is the heart rate based power meter. Now instantly you can see it does lag slightly behind the peaks and troughs of the other power meters. The reason for that being, when you are putting in any momentarily anaerobic efforts, obviously your heart rate doesn't instantaneously react to that. So that does explain it. Plus it does also follow generally the same lines, so that is good news after all. Now at this point I must actually say that PowerTap themselves say the Powercal is not the be-all and end-all solution to training with power, it's more of an introduction to it. Also, my maximum heart rate is actually quite low for my age, believe it or not. So it's 174. It always has been, ever since I started training with Heartrate back in 1995, believe it or not. So that could be possibly why my power reading isn't as high as the rest. So that's obviously using the formula of 220 minus your age being your maximum heart rate. But the good news is, like I said earlier, it does track generally in the same trajectory as the other power meters out there. So what's important here is that generally all of the power meters do track with one another. So there's no crazy dips or spikes in the graph, which is basically going to give you misleading results in the long term. Now, as for is there a best place to actually put a power meter on the bike? Well, there's a few variables here. So your budget, as well as compatibility issues. So if you've got just one bike, maybe the chainring solution is for you, because that's very much a fit and forget type situation, because you don't want to be swapping them from bike to bike. A couple of bikes, maybe you're looking at the pedals to move around, and the same goes for a wheel too. Just think about the future if you're going to buy any more bits of equipment.
So there we are. I'm sure you'll agree, some pretty interesting results there. But what I really want to know is, do you train with power? And if so, what method do you use? Let me know down there in the comments below. Remember as well to like and share this video with a friend, especially if you've got a friend who trains in the dark ages and just smashes themselves for hours on end. Anyway, do remember as well to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. And also, check out another video on training with power, click just down here.